morning and welcome to CERAWeek conversation presented by IHS Markit. And this morning I will be talking about the global oil market outlook for the next 10 years. And I'm joined by Ellen Curry, chief economist at ConocoPhillips, Spencer Dale, group chief economist at BP, Dr. Ayed Al-Kahtani, director of research at OPEC, and Jim Burkhardt, who heads IHS Markit, oil market and mobility research. So thank you all for joining us today. This is kind of a dream panel here to discuss what's going to be happening in the oil market. It's always a fun topic to have, but today really, I think I would not have any other four panelists than the one we have. I would like to talk first with Spencer, actually. Obviously, there have been a lot of discussion this year about what's the future of demand post-COVID for oil market. And I wanted to have a view from you and the scenarios that BP put out this summer about how demand would look like.
Thank you, Roger. And I think the truthful answer is we don't know. We know all of the scenarios we looked at in the energy outlook will be wrong. And the role of those outlooks isn't to predict the future, but to get, rather to get a sense about the range of uncertainty that we face. And I think when we think about oil demand over the next 10 years, I think in terms of that range of uncertainty on one side, I think we see oil demand recovering as the pandemic is brought under control and the vaccine is distributed widely around the world. Oil demand going back above its pre-COVID levels, but not rising materially above that level, sort of broadly flatlining, gradual growth, but broadly flatlining over the next 10 years. And then in other scenarios, the impact of COVID far more pronounced, such that although you get a recovery in oil demand from current levels, it never gets back to its pre-COVID levels. And you see a gradual decline of up to about 10 million barrels a day over the next 10 years. And so what we are thinking about when we're thinking about that range of uncertainty is that sort of code of uncertainty for oil demand over the next 10 or 15 years.
Thank you, Spencer. The demand issue obviously also really impact how we're going to be looking at investment and how much oil we would need over the next 10 years to come online. So how those scenarios in a way define that supply environment?
Yeah, and I think it's a key point, Roger, because I think many people sometimes when they hear sort of phrases like oil demand peaking, they sort of slip their derivative and somehow oil demand falls away very rapidly. Under all the scenarios both that we think about in BP, and I must admit that I've seen around the world, even if oil demand does peak in the near future and start to decline, the pace of that decline in demand is likely to be very slow relative to the natural base decline we see in production. So under all the scenarios that we are envisaging in BP, the world needs trillions of dollars of investment in new oil production over the next 10 or 15 years. And so I think one sort of constant under all of those is the need to see very substantial levels of investment. Oil continues to play a major central role in the global energy system under all those scenarios. And in order to support that, you need huge levels of investment, trillions of dollars of investment over the next 10 years in order to ensure adequate supplies of oil going forward.
Thank you. We'll come back to that supply issue, but I would like to have Ellen give us a little bit the view from ConocoPhillips, both on that demand outlook and the perception of a plateau or a slowly rise only of demand over the next 10 years, and then we'll come back to supply issues.
Yeah, sure. Thanks, Roger. I would actually echo almost every point that Spencer was making in regard to how demand will recover from COVID, as Spencer put very eloquently. We truly don't know. There's so many factors that are in play today that we can't know exactly where they will fall out in the next 3 to 5 years or 10 years. But what is important is that we do have a range of scenarios. We have scenarios in-house in ConocoPhillips as well, where we do have cases that we're in demand recovers and grows above its prior 100 million barrel a day level, but then does start to plateau and decline eventually in the long term. And then on the other side of that, we do have cases where demand doesn't fully recover, but it does plateau and the world does continue to need oil as well as natural gas. But in this case, oil is needed for a very long time. You can't just turn it off. There's too much of the global economy is dependent on oil and oil products. So it is needed for a long time. And as a byproduct, a lot of investment, trillions of dollars are needed to be invested in the upstream to be able to deliver on the world's energy needs.
Well, that's going to be the challenge, correct? Because depending how long it takes for oil demand and prices to recover, how much capital will be available for these investments become a critical issue. And there have been a number of price forecasts, especially from the investment banks, talking about a structural tightening or even a super cycle coming in because of this lack of investment. I think it depends a lot on how dynamic the demand is, obviously, in the next 5 years to be able to have that type of tightening. So I wanted to ask Dr. Al-Kahtani, how does OPEC sees demand and what are your main base case scenario for where demand is 10 years from now?
Well, thank you, Roger, and thank you for the IHS CERAWeek conversation for giving us all the privilege to be with you today and share with you some of the insight, probably on the short term, but you pinpointed 2030. That's the number that you want to discuss, but I just wanted to maybe extract some of the key messages and some of the numbers that we have shared already with the public domain last month in the release of our World Oil Outlook 2045. But before we dwell on that, I just wanted to stress on the point of the uncertainty mentioned by my colleagues here, which is definitely something that will encompass that everything that we do in the future. Not very long time ago, earlier this year, we were expecting the global economy to grow very healthy this year. Back in January, Montreal Market Report, we were forecasting north of 3% growth for the whole year. An upward revision from the month before, and we were thinking that the demand would grow 1.1 million barrels per day, very much in line with what our peers, colleagues in various agencies and institutions were thinking. But little we knew about what was coming our way in February, everything is changed, literally south significantly. Now we expect this year to witness an economic contraction of more than 4.3%. along with an oil demand contraction by almost 10 million barrels per day. The COVID-19 turned our world upside down. This is the uncertainty that within a few months we were facing, let alone something that you're talking about 10 years time horizon. But I'll try my best on behalf of the OPEC Secretariat team to share with you as much as we best can come up with in the next decade or so. Now, for the 2030, we hope that things will start coming back out of the hole next year. We expect next year to see a positive economic growth of 4.4%. And with that, an oil demand back to the positive territory north of 6 million barrels per day. We hope this will pull us gradually out of the COVID-19 big hole that we dug, that we were thrown into, with that demand and economic growth to continue growing at healthy levels to 2030 and then beyond to 2045. And if you allow me just very quickly to share with you some of the numbers that we see by 2030. We hope that the global economy will grow by another $43 trillion. That's reaching around 164. That's almost a 35% increase from the 2019 level. That economic growth will be catered or supported by another 11% growth in population by almost 800 or a little bit more than 800 million people. That will require an energy demand of growth of more than 30 million barrel of oil equivalent, which is another 11% above and beyond what we have seen in 2019. Just zooming into the oil component of that, we hope, or at least in the base case, we see the demand of oil growing by another 7.5 million barrels per day. That's 8% growth above the 2019 level of almost 100 million. So we see a little bit of space to catch up some of the lost demand territories for next year, thanks by large to the market stabilization effort that the OPEC and OPEC Plus have brought to the market, let alone the very constructive support role that we've seen outside OPEC. And April G20 is not far. I think the outcome of the collective global effort has enabled the markets to start stabilizing, registering back growth into the 2021 and beyond, reaching the 7.5 growth by 2030. And I can dwell into 2040.
Well, I wanted to ask Jim here. So what are the key driver of demand, since you had both crude oil market and mobility? And I wanted to start to go into there, is how much these structural changes we're seeing on demand, mobility in particular, and potential change of behavior after COVID, impact that view over 10 years? And is this one of the reasons we have a bigger range, if you want, of uncertainty going forward?
Right, then there's always a big range of uncertainty. And I think we just recognize that now because of what we've just all experienced. And when it comes to the long-term demand, I'll talk about cars in just a second, Roger, but if we look back in history, there's been two negative demand shocks in the last couple of decades. One was in the early 1980s and then in 2008, 2009 because of the financial crisis. One was caused by price, one was caused by economic contraction. This time around, it's caused by the sharp decline in oil demand is caused by a pandemic, which then led to a sharp contraction. But I think what history shows is when you have a big hit to demand like this, it does lower long-term demand. And our view is, even in our base case, which does show a recovery, demand out to 2030 is about 4 million barrels per day less than we had it before the pandemic. Now, there's some conflicting forces here. One is, people are using more cars as opposed to mass transit right now. The flip side of that is a lot of people aren't commuting into the office. But one really key trend that gets a lot of attention, and as well it should, and that is this, many jurisdictions are looking at more aggressive policies to ban internal combustion engines, to ban this the new sale of oil-powered cars. Now, whether how realistic those are, whether the timing that's been announced by some, like California in September said 2035, they want to ban new sales, that remains to be seen. There's a massive supply chain that still needs to be built out on that. But we are seeing two trends in mobility. One is ride hailing is really taking a hit because of the pandemic. The flip side of that is electrification aspirations, particularly in a number of jurisdictions around the world, have been increased. And those tend to offset one another in the short term, but in the long term, ride hailing will make a comeback, and the electrification push is only going to gain more momentum over time.
What I'm gathering from this conversation here on demand is in the next 10 years, we have uncertainty because we are at a pivot point from a structural point of view, and we don't know how much this revolution will impact the evolution of demand on one hand, and the other is the size of the recovery of demand because of the COVID crisis and the potential change for behavior. So we have quite a big range of outcome on demand. However, if you put that picture in the context where the oil market were in the last 4 years, where we had surplus and management of the market by OPEC, I would define the price regime we're in as a ceiling created by the amount of oil, actually the supply, coming out of North America in particular. So we're in the supply abundance with a narrative of supply abundance and the beginning of the perception of a demand constraint both from the technology and now from the economy. In that environment, I would want to flip a little bit on the supply side, because if you have a price environment, let's say, which is moderate, how do you bring this $1 trillion of investment into the supply to keep that moderation in prices, even in a demand weakness? In the sense that oil is a wasting asset, you need to invest every year to stay flat. Obviously, if your growth is limited, it reduces the amount of capital needed. But still, I would like to start with you, Ellen, here, because the U.S. was such a big element into the price regime we're in. How do you see shale and shale production evolving over the next 10 years into that type of demand uncertainty?
We have adjusted our viewpoint and our the way we're thinking about U.S. shale growth, tight oil specifically, coming out of this downturn this year. And part of that is not just the demand factors that have changed. It's many of the capital markets elements that are also essentially reshaping the playing field for U.S. producers. I think that the key thing, one of the key things to focus on is that vis-a-vis the pressures of the capital markets, E&Ps in the U.S., North America are going to be much more focused on capital discipline and low cost of supply. Those factors that you need to have in play in order to generate free cash flow and be able to provide returns to your investors. I think clearly the activity that we observed over the last 5 to 10 years is going to change with respect to the relationship between producers and their sources of capital. So what that then does is it limits the growth rate of U.S. production in the future. I do think that U.S. production will turn around and grow again. In the future, we're likely to see declines continuing into 2021. But once we get beyond that, I think it's likely that U.S. production will turn around and start to grow again. But it's less likely that we're going to see the annual growth rates of 1 million barrels a day and higher that we did see previously. So it comes back to there's it's not a question of the resource under the ground. What has changed is now the above ground factors and the access to capital that will limit the rate of growth for U.S. producers. But I do still think that U.S. production will be that flexible source of global supply. So it can still respond quickly to price signals. And that dynamic will continue to play out in the future.
Thank you. So, Spencer, to continue on that supply issue. So, Ellen, tell us limited growth in the U.S. in a low to medium price environment. But if prices go above a certain level, I'm paraphrasing you, Ellen, we can accelerate that growth. So that ability to turn the dial up in case of a spike in prices is still there, and the U.S. has still the ability to overwhelm demand if prices go above a certain threshold. Do you agree with that picture? And second, I would like to ask you about the rest of the world of supply.
Yes, I sort of very much share Helen's view. I think it's clear that the nature of US tight oil is going to change. Business model is going to change. We've seen levels of consolidation will increase. The nature of corporate financing will change. But the idea that sort of US tight oil introduces a sort of a flatness into the supply, into supply curve, and so therefore it helps to stabilize markets as demand increases, I think is likely to stay. The question we don't know is, What are the price trigger points and how have they changed? And have they changed fundamentally, or they just changed for a period of time until confidence returns and then they will adjust back down again? So I think that's the issue there. Outside of US tight oil, I think the issue here is firmly in terms of the low cost oil producers, in terms many of those being OPEC producers. And Dr. Al-Qahtani will know a lot more about that than I do. But in some sense, I think this is an issue for OPEC, where they're trying to balance the market. They're trying to increase their market share, but do that in such a way that keeps the market in balance. And that may well mean that they, after the market gets back to a more normal level, they may have to tread water for a while, where much of the marginal supply growth is driven by US tight oil, until we start to see some of those moving away from those sweet spots, allowing greater opportunities for OPEC to start to increase their market share again.
Well, you sidestepped all of the non-OPEC, non-US. I would like to take you back there a little bit. In this environment we're going to be in, that we define, are we seeing a lower activity in the rest of the world, basically, for production? Obviously, exploration is down, but really, where can we see growth outside of US and the low-cost producers?
So I think there's some obvious spots that we can see material growth going forward. So we see, for example, material growth in Brazil over the next few years, and that will be a point, that, a particular point that we would highlight. But I think this is, the general picture is one where in this world of muted demand growth, non-OPEC supply outside of the US and some particular areas like Brazil does start to get squeezed by the competition from a combination of US tight oil and OPEC and OPEC plus supplies.
Thank you, Spencer. Dr. Al-Kahtani, can you give us a little bit the view here from the low-cost producer, the OPEC members in particular? How much investment are expected in the next 10 years, and what type of market growth is perceived to be able to be captured by a higher supply?
Maybe if you allow me just to add on to the previous point, I talked about the demand. We talked quite heavily on the uncertainty, and I agree with my colleagues here in the panel that uncertainty will be definitely huge going forward, whether it relates to the exact timing, when do we get the vaccine in the very, very short term. Now we're talking months as opposed to years, but when we make it out of that slump, then the uncertainty changes gears and becomes more around the technology breakthroughs and the policies. We've seen the G20 summit outcome declaration last night, maybe adopting, endorsing the circular carbon economy, opening the door for a lot of producers, a lot of energy initiatives and policies. Definitely a policy and technology breakthroughs will be significant uncertainties going forward. But something, one thing for sure that we all know, that we need to grow, and we are making progress, making it out of this COVID repercussions into a medium term strong growth. My colleagues here, they've agreed on strong oil growth, whether it's 5 million or 7 million, at least we are witnessing a demand growth, and that is in order to facilitate for the economic growth. If we are to see the huge stimulus package, north of $12 trillion being injected into the global economy, definitely that will create a lot of growth, and we will need energy to grow that front. Now, on the structural change mentioned by my colleagues here, indeed we see a structural change because of the COVID, not only on the demand side, whereby we see an erosion of 1 million to 2 million barrels per day of absolute demand levels, whether we are talking 2030 or 2045, but definitely it imposes a structural change in the demand story as well on the supply. Now, on the supply side, your question, Roger, we expect the supply of the US shale to start coming back into the market as prices improve. Again, balancing the market remains to be a collective responsibility and effort, not only at OPEC. You probably mentioned that OPEC balances the market. It is OPEC plus the members into the Declaration of Cooperation, as well as outside the DOC, Declaration of Cooperation. We've seen Norway, we've seen the US contributing to that collective effort, and it's been very successful. The G20 at its level recognized this global effort to reinstate the stabilization into the market. Now, for the supply, I mentioned earlier that we expect the oil to grow by around 7.5 million barrels between now and 2030. And to match that, we expect the non-OPEC liquid supply to increase by about 6.5 million barrels per day. As for the production of OPEC, as depicted in our World Oil Outlook, and I invite you all to read through it, is that we expect the OPEC production, liquid production, to probably slightly drop in the short term. It was at 33.8 in 2019. We think it will be around 33 million barrels per day by 2025 before it catches up the wave to fill in the gap left by the plateauing, if not stagnating, supply outside OPEC member countries. We see the U.S. gradually picking up growth in the medium term. And then apart from the U.S. and a few other countries, we talked about Brazil, but we have Canada, Qatar, Kazakhstan, as well as Guyana, probably demonstrating growth between 2025 and 2030. And once they peak at around 72 million and they start declining, OPEC picks up the slack, increasing its total liquid production to around 36 million barrels per day by 2030. Definitely, this will come at a hefty cost of investment. We talked about the price tag of north of $12 trillion by 2045. If we zoom into the 2030, we would need around $6 trillion to be invested in the oil, upstream, midstream, and downstream. This is a significant tag price to put pipe in the ground and make sure that we avoid spikes. You talked about super cycles earlier, Roger. It's something that OPEC and its member countries, as well as their excellencies, have been warning around the lack of investment. We've seen investment contracting significantly by around 24-25% back in 15-16. We've seen it plunging by around 30% this year. This will have its consequences if we do not lay down the investment to facilitate for that demand growth when it materializes the next year and the years beyond. So definitely we will have to get back to the $300 to $400 billion investment per year to avoid any price hikes that may not be very healthy to the market participants, be it producers, consumers, or investors.
Thank you, Jim. We have a supply forecast, which also I think shows that toward the end of the period we're talking about here, we're going to see a material increase from the large resource holders in OPEC and OPEC Plus. How do you look at this price environment, and why do we have that concentration of growth happening in these countries in the medium term?
Well, one aspect of global oil supply, if you look at the big picture, you go back 50 years, what were the major sources of production 50 years ago? The Middle East, Eurasia, Russia, and North America. Today, it's those three regions. And we think 50 years from now, those three regions will remain pillars of supply. So first of all, a supply outlook is based on, where are the resources, where you think they will be produced. So I think that's a natural evolution of a long-term supply outlook. Now, there are surprises. The U.S. tight oil story in the 2010s, no one was looking at that in 2005. And if we were to have a period of high prices again, we'd have another period of discovery and innovation. Now, setting aside the potential for a number of years of high prices, it's simply where the resources are. And in terms of the cost structure, there is what we would call a large middle class in terms of global oil supply costs. When we look at the cost structure today, and it's come down some, not nearly as much as it did in 2015, 2016, but costs have come down some. And when we look at even a demand outlook where you have demand back up to pre-COVID levels by 2023 and then modestly growing after that, you need about $60 oil in real terms, in our view, to satisfy that demand. So a lot of that's going to come from the Middle East. We'll still be producing a lot of oil in the Middle East in 50 years, same in Russia and the U.S., but that broad middle class, $60 and below, whether it's Brazil, Guyana, or a number of other places, that points to a large resource base that can be that where supply can come on at moderate prices.
Yeah. Well, I want to stay a little bit on that capital constraint, in particular with our two guests here from the companies. I work mostly with the financial clients of IHS Markit, and there is this sense that the narrative has really changed between the supply abundance and the demand constraints and the carbon constraint, and how that carbon constraint is getting impact, is starting to impact capital formation, capital availability for these type of project. And I want to understand, how do you continue to plan and strategize around oil production for the next 10, 20 years? What type of input you have to do in the models to keep investment flowing into upstream oil? Spencer, would you like to take that first, and then Alan, and that would be our conclusion?
So I think from a corporate perspective, this is the world of increasing capital discipline. And I think that capital discipline takes many different dimensions. The one capital discipline we've always seen is that shareholders will demand a return on their investments, and will demand proof that they're going to get a good return, expected return on their investments. I think another part of that capital discipline is a recognition that the future of oil demand is uncertain. How long oil demand will carry on growing for is far more uncertain now than it ever was if you go back 10, 15 or 20 years or so. And so therefore, the resilience of the investment of the oil you're invested in becomes increasingly important. Can this oil compete in a world where if oil demand turns out to slow and start to fall more quickly than you expect? And so I think the challenges in terms of transparency and to prove that you're only investing in resilient oil. And I think the final component to that is the carbon intensity of the oil you're investing in. Increasingly, the type of investors that we have invested in BP, they care about the return on their investments, but they also care about what the impact that those investments have on the planet, on the wider environment, and therefore, yes, one can still carry on investing in oil and gas, but you need to make sure that you can demonstrate you're investing in the lowest carbon intensity oil and gas that is possible. So I think any flows of capital is still there, but I think the demands in terms of discipline, transparency, the nature of the investments are changing relative to what we've seen in the past.
Thank you, Spencer. Because what you're telling me here, in a way, that low-cost, low-carbon producer will move to provide the bulk of the growth, the baseline of the growth, which are a lot of the countries in the Persian Gulf, where we can produce both low cost and low carbon, but that the marginal balance of the market remain the U.S. And that takes me back to Helen here, is we need to have the sense that the reformed shale sector probably consolidated, larger company, more capitalized, more attuned to shareholders need to continue to have, though, that ability to dial up or down at a certain price threshold. And that's going to one of the uncertainty that we have. Do you see the U.S. capable 3-4 years down the road to be able, within 6, 12, 18 months, let's say, go from 500,000 barrel per day growth to a million and a half if needed?
I think you would have to see the right kind of price signal in order for U.S. producers to respond in that magnitude, because what the environment that they're operating in and that they would need to be able to respond within goes back to the notion of, do you have low cost of supply, and can you produce those barrels in an environmentally responsible and sustainable fashion, such that you still have free cash flow to return to your investors? I think in the coming years, I'm hopeful that we'll be pleasantly surprised with how the U.S. producers collectively step up and respond to the greater requirements around environmental responsibility. I think that as Spencer was pointing out, the capital market pressures are going to demand greater transparency. So what will have to come along with that is the notion of raising the floor around sustainable practices in the US and across North America. But to circle back to your direct question, in order to see U.S. production grow close to 1 million barrels a day, it's all about, do you have the market environment led by a price signal to be able to drive that.
Okay, thank you. That's not very very different than from the environment we had, maybe with different threshold. Dr. Al-Kahtani, would you like to tell us how you look at that market and how it's reactive going forward?
I just wanted to add a point to what my colleagues have already mentioned. We've seen the U.S. Shale industry demonstrating its ability to compete. We've seen an efficiency improvement back with the price collapse of the 2014-2015. We've seen north of almost 40% efficiency improvement. And that is to survive the lower price environment. Remember, we've needed the shale so badly to cater for the growth that we've seen out of the 2008 financial crisis. That is to cool off the prices and offer alternative, probably cheaper sources of supply, catering the markets to finance the economic growth that we've seen back in those years. With the price collapse, we've seen an efficiency improvement. And this year, we probably are registering positive free cash flows for the first time in several years by at least the top 39 shale companies in the U.S. I wouldn't be surprised that due to the new skills and new ways of reducing costs and improving efficiency, that we would see volumes coming back to the market at a lower price bands. I will not address certain price band, but you talked earlier about the $60. I think that would be a very healthy price environment, but I think the growth could materialize at much lower than that, given the efficiency that they have realized. Talking 2030, we believe at the Secretariat that the U.S. tight crude could grow by another 2.5 million. That is up from the 7.7 that we've seen in 2019. As for the tight oil, including the NGLs, again, the shale gas is another story that we have to keep an eye on. We think that they easily can maybe add north of 4 million barrels back to the market. That is added to the 11.7 we've seen in 2019. Again, we think that with this efficiency improvement, with the improving price environment next year and the years to follow, in light of the demand recovery, we think that that environment would be facilitative to all producers, not only in the U.S. shale, but also in the Gulf region, whereby we see the low cost of production. I think we are getting back to somehow an environment out of the 2008. Getting out of a crisis and requiring all sources of energy to facilitate for the growth that we've witnessed. And if anything, learning from history, which demonstrated not to be very far away, I think we will get back to the OPEC main takeaway conclusions in our WU, which indicated that we will need all sources of energy still dominated by oil, mainly in the transport and the petrochemical sector, but also all sources of energy would be required. We will see some of them growing faster than others, but the picture will not change by a whole lot. And that's because the greener components of the global energy mix will remain to be a smaller portion because they start from a very low base. Back to you, Roger.
Thank you, Dr. Al-Kahtani. Let me wrap up this discussion here. What we heard today is a lot of uncertainty on demand, the perception that we're coming close to a plateau or lower growth. But Dr. Al-Kahtani also remind us that economic growth and population growth might mean that the structural changes that we're expecting might not have such a big impact in the next 10 years on demand. On the supply side, there's clearly capital constraint and the notion that resources will come up from really two sources of low cost oil in the United States as not only low cost, but a quick reactivity to prices after a certain threshold. Same system that we had in the last 4 or 5 years. The question is how much shale 3.0 have been tamed by capital. That's to a certain degree an uncertainty, but to a large is not. We're seeing the restructuring of the U.S. Oil sector. And the rest of supply really has to come, it looks like, from the large, low-cost, low-carbon footprint producers and their willingness to put the capital in place, even in a lower price environment, to prepare for the future and allow that oil future to continue with us, even if it's a plateau or a limited growth or a large growth. Capital still had to come in, even in prices between, let's say, 50 and 65 to give us the future of oil. Thank you very much for your time. Thank you for my panelists. That was a great conversation. And I hope we sometime next year at Sierra Week will be next to each other on a panel. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you very much, IHS. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Thank you.